hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
God spake these words and said, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt have no other gods but me. Thou shalt not make to thyself any graven image, nor the likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor worship them. Perfect remission and forgiveness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
epistle for the fifth Sunday in Lent, commonly called Passion Sunday, is written in the ninth chapter from the book of Hebrews, starting with the second verse. It can be found on page 132 of the 1928 Book of Common Prayer. Christ being come an high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats, and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that we were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Here endeth the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise.
Services are virtually canceled. We're having our services here because we still want to do the work of the church, which is to continue to pray for the world and to offer Christ up for the sake of the world, Christ who was once sacrificed for us. We remembering that sacrifice and joining ourselves with it, offering it up for the sake of the world. And so here we are again, just a few of us. Just a handful of us here, just the bare minimum for us to have a service, and we'll continue to be doing that for the foreseeable future. Of course, there are no other events going on at this point. The only other things that are happening is that three times a week on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday nights, we are broadcasting evening prayer from my home on those evenings at 9 p.m., and anybody can join in with that. That can be found on our Facebook page. It will be live streamed there. We will continue to live stream services on Sunday. We actually have a camera system that's installed, but we had a little issue with getting the sound to work together with everything. Hopefully, over the next week, that will all be sorted out. In the meantime, I think that's that. So, where are we? We're in John chapter 8. Now, for the past few weeks, what we've been doing is we've actually been taking a look at the collects for the day. I think for some reason they seem to be hitting home at this season and with what we're going through. So the collect for today, I'm going to repeat. We beseech thee, Almighty God, mercifully to look upon thy people, that by thy great goodness they may be governed and preserved evermore, both in body and soul through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the collect is insightful. It asks that we may be governed and preserved in body and soul by virtue of God's goodness. Now, none of us can really take issue with that. We all want that. Or do we? To be preserved is one thing. To be governed is entirely another. We want to be governed neither in body or soul. Neither in body or soul. Yet we still want to be preserved. This is a problem. This is our dilemma. The fact is that Jesus teaches us that one does not come without the other. In the gospel reading, we find that Jesus is engaged in an argument with the Pharisees. The gospel reading begins near the end of an entire encounter where Jesus challenges his detractors to convince him of sin, or to convict him of a sin. And it ends with this bold declaration that he makes. He says, before Abraham was, I am. But it begins with another bold declaration. In fact, it is this bold declaration that starts out this whole dialogue. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. In fact, in this portion of Scripture, there are at least two of the most notable and probably misquotable declarations Jesus has ever made. The first, I am the light of the world. Well, who doesn't like to say that? Jesus is the light of the world, and he is, right? And then Jesus also says in this discourse, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. How many of us have heard that? It's quoted offhand all the time. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. But the problem is, what truth are we even talking about? Any truth? Well, this is a problem today. Now, it's because of these declarations that the Jews challenge him. These are outrageous claims that Jesus makes. And outrageous claims require solid testimony And this is why they question him. Because they're saying, well, you testify on your own account. And Jesus goes on to say, well, my account is true and the Father testifies with me, right? So Jesus makes these bold claims. And in fact, and I love that Jesus does this, Jesus has no fear. He doubles down. He doesn't backtrack on any of these things. He says, I am the light of the world. And then he goes on to say, you shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. If you are my disciples and stay in my word. Right? And then Jesus finishes with the bold declaration, the most outrageous of all, before Abraham was, I am. And at that, they were ready to stone him, because now, as far as they're concerned, he is blasphemed. But the fact is he is the light of the world to those who walk in darkness, and he is the light of life. The fact is, I think we could all use a little of that light right about now. We all seem to be walking in darkness. That's how it seems these days, doesn't it? I have to be honest, though, most of the people that I know, that I hang out with, most of the people in our parish don't seem to be living in fear. Now, we respect the fact that there's a very contagious thing out in the air and that people are getting sick, but most of the people that I speak to in my parish are not slaves of fear. They're not bound up with fear. They're not overly anxious. They're not worried. And I'm happy to report that we at Trinity seem to possess the light of life. We seem to possess that light that Jesus is speaking about. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And whoever follows me will have the light of life. And that light is burning here, I'm happy to say. But I know that there are others who do not seem to have this light. There are others who are walking in darkness. There are others who are going about in the world deeply frightened and concerned and dismayed and filled with anxiety and fear. And that's really not the way we're supposed to be living. Jesus says, I am the light of the world, and whoever believes in me shall have the light of life. And it's with that light that we navigate things like this. For those for whom Christ is the light of their world, they're not afraid of the impending darkness and gloom. They're not weighed down by dread. They're not afraid even to die. Jesus goes on to speak to those who believed up to that point, after he makes this first claim saying, I am the light of the world. He goes on to say, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Again, one of those most quotable texts. And they take offense at this, suggesting that they're not free. Jesus seems to be implying that they're not free. And so they're thinking in natural terms about freedom and slavery. Now, I think if Jesus spoke these words on air in any news program in the United States, most Americans would probably take offense as well. What do you mean we're Americans? We live in a free democracy. We've never been under the heels of any tyrant. Or been subject to slavery or anything like that. What do you mean? But we too fail to see the ways in which we have been enslaved to money, to pleasure, to politics, to ideologies, to weed, to toys, to property, to houses. We've been made slaves to a great many other things. And we can't recognize our own slavery. This is a problem. The same way the Jews that Jesus spoke to could not understand what they were enslaved to. They thought of it in merely natural terms. Jesus was speaking in spiritual terms, in what captures the heart, in what leads us away from God. I think sometimes that we don't even know what freedom is. We've been slaves for so long. And that happens after a while. After a while, you begin to naturalize yourself to it like a tiger. tiger in an old zoo. Have you ever seen a tiger in an old zoo? I've seen a couple of those zoos, probably most of us have. Not the ones where the animals get to roam around, but the small cage where the tiger doesn't have a lot of room and he paces back and forth in front of the cage, back and forth, back and forth, and he's mangy looking and tired. But you can tell that there's no fight in him. There's almost no life in him. He's grown accustomed to life in a cage. This is what happens to us. No matter what it is that we're enslaved to, we begin to naturalize to it, and we become comfortable with it, and we begin to think that this is all that life is. This is a huge problem. Now, Gregory, the 4th century bishop of Nyssa, says this about this sort of slavery. He says, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. That is, turning to evil in any matter and situation somehow enslaves a person and puts, now listen to this, and puts the stigma of a runaway slave on the person with scars and brands inflicted by the blows of sin. What an image. The image of a runaway slave. We, many of us, fear because we live with the stigma of a runaway slave with scars and brands inflicted by sin. Again, many of us want to say, well, what are you talking about? I mean, how could you even talk about slavery? That's politically incorrect. But the reality is that many of us, while we're trying to be politically correct with the world, are slaves to our own sins. And this is a huge problem. We don't recognize how sin creates fear in the soul. Runaway slaves live in fear of being found and caught. Like criminals, we also live with the stigma of sin branded on our souls. And when calamity strikes, we fear like an undocumented alien when ICE comes calling. You don't even want to show up at the hospital because you're afraid that maybe you're going to be taken away. And this is what happens to us under situations like this. When there's fear that prevails in the air, we have this stigma of something like a runaway slave in our hearts and souls because we have been captured by sin. And until our conscience is cleansed, we can't know any freedom. Jesus says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. As long as our conscience condemns us, we can't know peace. And this is what the writer to the Hebrews says. Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. This is what's got to happen. And this is why for us we have the light of Christ, because those who come to Christ with all of their hearts, all their souls, all their mind, all their strength, they have had their consciences cleansed. They are no longer runaway slaves. They're free. We are free interiorly. I no longer carry the brand of a runaway slave. Christ has set us free. This is the glorious thing about the gospel, that those who come to Christ and lay their hearts at his feet have their consciences cleansed. Now, I understand that people want peace, and they don't want to be afraid in the face of something like the virus that's going around. But the reality is that we will not have peace until we have made peace with God. And God has made provision for it. He's made provision for the cleansing of our conscience from death, from sin. He's made provision to remove the stigma of slavery, spiritual slavery, that has bound our hearts through Christ. Christ's death and resurrection has set us free. It has broken the bounds, the bonds of slavery to sin. But we can't know that peace until we begin to recognize our rebellion and the fact that we are runaways. It brings us back to this passage about being governed by God in body and soul. You see, as long as I don't want to be governed by God in body and soul, I am basically like a slave on the run. God has made provision for that stigma to be removed. So how is it that we should know the truth? When we abide in his word as his disciples. When we submit to be governed by God as much as we want to be preserved by him. This is when we begin to know interior peace. I'm going to say that again. When we submit to be governed by God in body and soul, as much as we want to be preserved by him from all of the things that make us afraid or threaten us, this is when we begin to know interior peace. This is when the slave comes home to his rightful master, and when we submit ourselves to his will. Jesus continued, he said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he shall never taste death." This is the next thing that's quite disputed that Jesus says and causes a lot of dismay among the Jews that hear him. And we're certainly not talking about the destruction of the body, but the continuation of the soul uninterrupted and undisturbed. Why are we afraid? Why are we afraid of this flu or this thing? Well, it's because we're really not prepared for death. We're not prepared to die. We are still slaves on the run. Now, God has brought this Lenten meditation to the forefront of our minds with the situation that we find ourselves in. Of course, we begin Lent, and we began Lent before all of this stuff really began to happen. We begin Lent with the signing of ashes on the forehead to remind us that we are but dust, and to dust we shall return. It reminds us that death is imminent and that we will one day have to give account for our lives. Ash Wednesday is the yearly reminder for Christians that death will come and that if we have prepared our souls, we can face it without fear. However, this threat has uncovered the fact that many of us are afraid to die. Jesus' words reassure us that if we have been governed by him and the soul and the body, we shall not taste death. That is, we may die, of course. We're all going to die. But the sting of it, the fear of it, its black darkness and hallowed caverns will not threaten our eternal souls. When the gates of death close in over us, we won't have to be afraid. This is the promise of the Christian life. Not that we're going to be nicer people in the here and now. Of course, that's expected. But the real promise of the Christian life is that death is overcome, and we no longer have to fear the sting of it, because we shall pass from life to life itself. We shall not die, but we shall have the light of life, because the one who gives us the light of life is the great I Am. And that is where we find our faith, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept these our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice, to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who, in this transitory life, are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, addiction, persecution, or any other adversity. I invite you to lift up by name those you bear upon your heart. We also bless thy holy name for all thy servants, departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant us, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Ye who do truly and earnestly repent thee of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and forth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make an humble confession before Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and beware of our manifold sins and wickedness, which we, from time to time, most grievously have committed, by thought, word, or deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and on our hearts sorrow for these earnest feelings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy on us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the peace of life. The honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Lord Jesus Christ saith to all who truly turn unto him. Come unto me, all you that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
its reward upon us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and
and sustain us with thine unceasing help, those whom thou hast refreshed with thy mysteries through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty, never-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou hast vouchsafed to feed us who have duly received these holy mysteries. With the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and just assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue